Nagash is an integral part of the continuing lore of Age of Sigmar. As the god of death and ruler over Shaiish, the realm of death, he is in direct opposition to Archaon the Everchosen, but has double-crossed Sigmar on more than one occasion. Nagash rules over a vast range of different undead servants, but one specific race stands out among the rest. Vampires were always a massive part of Warhammer Fantasy's lore, the Von Karsteins and the many bloodlines that stretch from the first vampires of ancient Nehekara into the world that was. In Age of Sigmar, most of the vampires and their bloodlines are muddled in relative obscurity, except for one, the Flesh Eater's Court. The lore of the Flesh Eater's Court is a pretty expansive one, actually. It dips into elements of the world that was, jostling up decadent memories of the regal courts of the Bretonians and echoes of the lost kingdom of Morkane in ages past. As that lore then evolves forward into the current timeline, we get a very interesting and dynamic story of a former King of the Night, lost to the madness in his fractured mind, and how that goes on to spawn these sprawling charnel kingdoms. So let's get started on a lore that takes a fun and rather original twist with the Flesh Eater's Court. Now, this all begins in the Age of Myth, one of the three ages of the setting: Myth, Chaos, and Sigmar. Go figure. The Age of Myth is a time shortly after the end times of Warhammer Fantasy, when Sigmar discovers the mortal realms and reunites elements of humanity, all sorts of fun shenanigans. Now, our tale then begins in the Nightlands of Shaiish, with the very first Abhorrent, as it is called. He was a favored servant of Nagash and ruled over a vast kingdom filled with knights and nobles, each one a lawful child of the night. You get this very poignant image of the ancient kingdom of Morkane brought to life in the earliest days of Age of Sigmar. Morkane was the city ruled over by the Strigoi king Ashoron, which leads me to the name of the Abhorrent, Ashoron the Handsome, the Blood Rose Prince. The book talks about how Ashoron traveled the realm of Nagash, collecting tithes and enforcing the God of Death's order upon those who would seek to disobey their liege. He kind of ushers some into the underworld. He's a very kind of benevolent and fair and just ruler. Over time, Ashoron fell from grace in the eyes of Nagash, and unfortunately, this part of the history is muddled by one of those lost to the passage of time sentences in the Battle Tome. But whatever misdeed Ashoron committed, it must have been great, because Nagash's punishment was harsh and long-lasting. Rather than the resplendent lord of the night that Ashoron had been, Nagash cursed him, resulting in a bestial transformation that terrified onlookers. Angered and embittered by the punishment, Ashoron's malice was meted out to the people of the Nightlands. Rather than granting boons, as the book calls it, kingdoms were waylaid and destroyed, their lords slain and populace slaughtered and consumed by the Blood Rose Prince. This enraged the great necromancer, and Nagash summoned the Mortarks of Night, Sacrament, and Blood to quell the uprising caused by Ashoron and his armies. Now, for those of you who don't know, those Mortarks are Manfred von Karstein, Arkhan the Black, and Neferata respectively, Night, Sacrament, and Blood. The Flesh Eater's Court tome does not discuss whether or not Ashoron has any memory of his life from the world that was. In fact, it doesn't really touch upon the lore of Morkane and the fact that Ashoron was actually the brother of Neferata in the older Warhammer Fantasy lore. Towards the end of the End Times, Ashoron actually kind of rallies with Abhorash to help out in the, I guess it's kind of like a Siege of Mousseon 2.0. But Ashoron kind of inhabits the depleted and dilapidated warrens underneath Mousseon to kind of recreate a smaller kingdom during the end times. And Abhorash comes to help him fight off some Skaven that are attacking him. And that's really one of the last times we even see Ashoron. So it's weird that they don't really touch on that at all. I mean, he might know Manfred von Karstein, but he would most definitely know Arkhan and Neferata if this is indeed the same Ashoron. Since there's no really conclusive evidence, I cannot say either way. Only a murky passage towards the end of the lore talks about Nagash knowing the true history of Ashoron. But I wanted to bring this up, as I know a lot of you that have followed the Strigoi over the years are probably wondering where the lore intersects. For all intents and purposes, it doesn't seem to, but let's get back on track. In the wake of Asheron's brutal transformation, he spawned what is regarded as the First Court. Even though Nagash's curse left him physically grotesque, his knights and nobles were staunchly devoted to Asheron and rallied to his cause, defending their king in the face of Nagash's Mortarks. Asheron and Nagash's forces clashed across many years of brutal wars that left the First Court ravaged and beaten. In the end, the Mortarks were able to capture Asheron and bring him to a cursed prison known as the Shroud Cage. Nagash wouldn't settle for just putting his wayward servant in a cage of cast iron. Instead, the Shroud Cage reflected endless truths upon the king, as stated in the battle tome. The years dragged on as truth and lie were indistinguishable, much like trying to recall a night out with friends where you woke up with a broken phone and one sock on. The endless assault on Asheron's mind broke the once proud Blood Rose Prince, his twisted and horrifying body mirroring the wreck that his mind had become, a convulsing, twitching mess of delusion and insanity. There is no telling how long Asheron spent in the Shroud Cage, but as the Age of Myth drew to a close, so did the Age of Chaos begin. The return of the arch-enemy, Chaos, in the lands of the Mortal Realms galvanized Sigmar to act against Archaon's endless legions. In the opening years of the aforementioned age, Nagash betrayed the God-King Sigmar, deserting their alliance. The result was a wrathful and swift retribution as Sigmar and his Stormcast Eternals strike like lightning through the lands of Shaiish. Elements of the defunct First Court were able to lead portions of Sigmar's armies to the Shroud Cage, toppling the grand walls of the prison. Sigmar left Shaiish after successfully bending Nagash to his will. Later on, Archaon would actually slay Nagash, at least temporarily, and sending the entire realm into an upheaval, with a huge power vacuum emerging, with the God of Death stolen away by his Mortarks while he restores his power. The ensuing chaos allowed for Asheron to scamper off into the darkness like Gollum, "Stupid Nagash ruins all my plans, precious!" And thus is born the legacy of the Carrion King. No longer going by the name of Asheron, I'd even argue that he probably doesn't even remember that's his name, the Carrion King sought to rebuild the legacy of the First Court. Some of the knights and nobles of the age rallied to Asheron's banner once more, but the mind of the Carrion King was a fractured and broken thing, and with that came a great outpouring of the madness within him, infecting all of those around. Part of the madness and allure of the Flesh Courts is how this manifests around the Carrion King. Asheron believes, truly and utterly, that he is still the pristine and noble champion that he was before his fall, before Nagash cursed him. And that he leads this kind of illustrious court of chivalry and virtue. And this lie spreads to everyone that follows the Carrion King. On the outside, the man that was might be hunched over and animalistic, but on the inside, he sees himself as a worthy king, ruling over a feudal land of rolling hills and simple beauty. With Nagash hidden away in the underworld of Styx, regaining his lost power, the Carrion King creates vast kingdoms throughout the land of Shaiish. The broken populace of mortals that stalk through the ruined kingdoms by the ravaging hordes of chaos result to cannibalism, using whatever means necessary to eke a living out of their shattered lives. The Carrion King's arrival gives hope to these cannibalistic humans, his madness infecting them and bearing the fruit of the very first Mordants, ghoulish cannibals that believe wholly in this insanity that seeps from the Carrion King's mind. The blood granted by the first Abhorrent gives them a taste of the shared delusion as each one thinks them a worthy servant in a grand court. The Battle Tome has a great quote on page 9. "So it is that each flesh-eater court is a reflection of the first court, their abhorrents trying to recreate in madness the memories passed on to them through blood." The Flesh-Eater Courts grew in strength throughout the Mortal Realms, expanding out from Shaiish and raging back against the marauding forces of Chaos. As the Age of Chaos drew to a close, the might of the Abhorrents and their Mordant followers grew. Each destroyed civilization and city became the host to a new court, rising up in the delusional wake of a visiting Abhorrent. These courts echo the sentiment of ancient Britannia and the world that was. I'd go so far as to say that this is what Britannia has become in the Age of Sigmar, a broken kingdom of raving cannibals that have survived through the ravages of the dark gods to spawn some fiendish mockery of the virtues that made up the cornerstone of long-lost Britannia. Each court grew in power across the lands of Taish, and in time, the legend of the Carrion King passed into just that, legend. And the whereabouts of the primogenitor of the Flesh-Eater courts became shrouded in mystery. Ashran remains, to this day, hidden somewhere in the mortal realms, away from the prying eyes of Nagash, as he continues to grow his decadent kingdoms of cannibals. The Age of Chaos would go on with more and more courts up in what became the Carrion Lands, the old lands of the once magnanimous Ashran. The Carrion Lands, in time, before the Carrion King's fall, was a land of marvelous ghost galleons and the crowning jewel of the soul-plighted empires of Shaiish. Now it is a shambling ruin of cannibals, with abhorrence ruling from atop thrones of desiccated mortal remains. Each court is a twisted mockery and imitation of the first court, which Ashran resided over and ruled before his slip into madness. The court is ruled over by an abhorrent ghoul king. And indeed, there are instances where multiple courts fall under one abhorrent arch-regent to form a kingdom of their own. And just to kind of keep in mind, I'll remind you guys later at the end of this segment, because there are so many kind of swinging back and forth of the use of the word abhorrent and mordant. Abhorrent is typically a individual who is a vampire, a mordant who has been given the blood kiss, more or less, quote-unquote, by another abhorrent, and he takes part even more so in the delusion of the abhorrent ghoul king. A mordant would just simply be a ghoul, even a varghul if it's considered a mordant. But take this journey with me. You're on a quest that takes you through the ruins of a once great city. Grand towers toppled and stone facades broken to different stages of decay as dust wisps itself around your ankles with each step. You pass through what appears to be the threshold of a large, great hall. Tattered banners hang from jagged rods protruding from the walls. Moving further and further into the keep, the air takes on a different smell and becomes dank with the sourness of something both rotten and forgotten. Heavy oak doors strain against smashed hinges as you climb through the small opening created by the doors resting against one another. In the newest room, the walls expand upward to a vaulted wooden ceiling, the roof rotted through. That's not the first thing you notice. The first thing you notice is the smell. The sting of death bites your nose hard as your vision becomes disoriented from the squalor and filth around you. Glowing eyes stare back at you as you take in the cursed banquet hall. Massive beasts with wings three times the size of a man emit low growls, slow, plodding footsteps pound with the thumping of your heart. The gibbering of hundreds, if not thousands, of creatures all around you send the hairs on the back of your neck standing. And then you hear something like that of laughter as your eyes fall upon the figure standing on a mockery of a throne. The alabaster terror's lips are betrayed by the deep crimson that stains his mouth and teeth. Behind him are large banners stitched together, skin, faces, hair, and mismatched tonality, adding to the menagerie of terror before you. Now that is what it would appear for any outsider stepping into the court of the Ghoul King, but not to the inhabitants of the court. Those smashed towers reach into the sky like gleaming pinions. The Great Hall is an ornate inner keep, with heraldry and banners all still intact, leading to a marvelous banquet hall filled with juggling bears, jesters, and all the vagaries of the typical court's festivities. The book pretty clearly states out the breakdown of the entire court, with sycophants filling out the royal family of the Ghoul King and mirroring the naming of the first court. The king then has their own attendants in the Lord Chamberslaw, who uses the Crypt Haunter Courtiers to rule over the Lickspittles, which are composed of the court crypt horrors. From there, we get the Dead Watch and the Lord Marlbroth, and that's a title, not a name, who is the first knight of the Dead Watch. The Dead Watch's goal is to defend and safeguard the kingdom, with the Lord Marlbroth acting as one of the most loyal servants under the Ghoul King, utilizing the elite soldiers, if they can be called that, of the Dead Watch to safeguard the throne room. Then you get other colorful names like the Marquis Gruelslop, which rules over the Royal Mordants. So pretty much, just to kind of recap here, pretty much anything that isn't an abhorrent is just a mordant. Remember the distinction. A mordant is essentially a vampire, an abhorrent is essentially a vampire, while a mordant is just a creature like a ghoul, crypt horror, vargulf, and the such. The lore on things such as Gvargulf have changed a bit too, so it doesn't fit the older lore, which says that they were vampires, so keep that in mind. But as you look at the rest of the court, you have people in charge of the Royal Menagerie, which is where the zombie dragons and terrorgeists are held for the court in question. And in fact, they even think that dragons are griffins. Like, they have such a crazy delusion across all these other beasts. The picture you've been looking at is straight out of the battle tome that breaks down how the courts are constructed, their naming, everything. It's actually a very interesting and original breakout from the typical kind of vampire aristocracy. I think this sort of court system, or twisted take on feudal kingdoms, really gives the flesh-eater courts a lot of flavor and character. Vampirism in Age of Sigmar is a bit different than it was, or is, in Warhammer Fantasy. It's definitely a bit fewer and further between so far in the narrative, whether this is because we haven't seen a true vampire count-style faction yet, or if there was a need to reduce their overall presence, we can't be too sure. But even with this elaborate court system, one thing remains true for each and every court, Archregent and Ghoul King. They are all born from the bloodline of the Carrion King, and no one is above the might of the first Abhorrent. As we round out the lore of the Flesh Eater's Court, we come into the current Age of Sigmar. And this is the age which the narrative of the game really takes place. And here, the courts thrive throughout many of the mortal realms, having embedded themselves in Haish, Girin, Akshi, Shaman, Ulgu, all over the place really. The realm gates have become an area that the courts seem to gravitate towards, and have made their homes around these gates, allowing them to connect with other courts and other realms, strengthening their, I guess you could say, alliances. Remember, to these debased, wretched ghoul kingdoms, they think they're these grand kings in charge of beautiful, sprawling lands, sending scouting parties, read ghoul patrols, to expand their borders and discover enemies. As these cursed courts crop up all over the mortal realms, the real question is, what does Nagash have to say about this? Well, fitting the delusion of their primogenitor, the constant flux of truth and lie that inhabited his mind seems to have spread down to the courts. He created, depending on what portion of truth or lie he was reeling through. Now, what I mean by that is that some courts look at Nagash as a benevolent god, worthy of their worship and praise, making great sacrifices, offering their services, and committing tithes to the god of death. While other courts, namely the largest nation outside of Nagash's influence, Highhaven, see him as the cruel tyrant that the Carrion King once did, and will take whatever measure or means necessary to ensure their independence from the realm of death, even creating wards and other sorts of magic that will actually repel the unliving. But now that we've come full circle on the vast history of the Flesh Eater Courts, I hope you'll have a better understanding of this pretty amazing faction in the Age of Sigmar continuum. The lore behind them is really interesting and truly original as far as vampire factions go, and they play a pretty crucial role in the sort of geopolitical status of the age, selling their services or allying with whichever side makes the most sense for their motives, be it human, undead, chaos, or even beast. The Flesh Eater Courts are, you know, independent, each one of them. It's its own entity with its own motivations and goals. So one final fact I want to bring up is how the Flesh Eaters perceive death. Because their delusion is so strong in life, or at least, you know, the halfway point that they inhabit between undeath and living, that when they die, their souls are typically at peace. Huge swaths of the underworld are peaceful kingdoms filled with the deceased members of the court. Whatever they believed in life, they live in death. And here's a direct cut from page 13 in the Battle Tome. So it was that when a new court was formed, the afterlife into which its mordants passed when they died remained largely unchanged. Courts who believed themselves to be pastoral fiefdoms had unworlds in which spirits dwelt amongst lush fields, spending days rearing herds of livestock and nights making merry with their fellow honored dead. Similarly, Mordens, who saw themselves as gallant beast slayers, spent their afterlife slaughtering endless series of monstrosities, holding aloft the severed heads as commoners showered them with flower petals. Now, with the most recent Necroquake unleashed by Nagash, this has sort of cracked that belief, and the once serene underworld lands of the courts have become twisted hellscapes of Mordens, driven mad by the truth of what they were in life. It's a real awesome dichotomy that Games Workshop has created, with the delusion and reality of their lives echoed across eternity by their creator, the Carrion King, Ashoron the Blood Rose Prince, and very first, the Flesh Eater's Court. I hope you guys enjoyed this journey into another faction in Age of Sigmar. I'd like to really hit on some more factions with the Slaves of Darkness, or To Darkness, and maybe even the Blades of Khorne. If you'd like me to do the lore on the individual conclaves of, say, for the Idoneth Deepkin, or even the Flesh Eater's Court, go ahead and let me know in the comments below. I'd love to really crack this lore wide open for you all, and help kind of dispel some of the negative stigma around the Age of Sigmar lore. Either way, thank you all so much for watching here today. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Can't say how huge that is. And leave a comment about what other Age of Sigmar lore you'd like me to get into or you'd like to know about personally. But as always, guys, have a good one and take care.